All right, let's get into the Word of God today. Let's say a prayer together. Father, we thank you because one of the biggest things you give us is your Word. And your Word has a way of changing us, teaching and renewing our minds. Once again, we come here to submit to your Word. I am what the Word of God says I am. I have what the Word of God says I have. I'm healthy, I'm strong, because the Word says so. Today, as we confess and look at the Word of God, speak to wherever you have from a deep place. Lord, in Jesus' name, this is a brand new series. Let there be healing and interventions in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now, for all of us in the fourth service, we are a bit familiar with this kind of teaching. In the other services, it's a throwback. So, in this month, we're talking specifically about overcoming depression. So, I will do a lot of teaching. Then, towards the end, we'll have some time to have some intervention. Overcoming depression. And I will share my own depression story. Not too long ago, someone says, because when I share my story, not too long ago, within the last five years, because when I share these stories, people think it's a long time that this happened. Within the last 5 years, I found myself in a place that was a very dark place. I got very depressed, and I became suicidal. I actually became suicidal. I'd gone through maybe what I would call the biggest disappointment, betrayals in my life, in ministry. The beautiful thing of not being a pastor is this. When you have a challenge at work in your marriage, in your life, you can run to church and run to the pastor to help you. That's the beautiful thing of being a pastor. But most of the time, when a pastor has trouble, what does he have the trouble with? He has the trouble with the church, that there's no way he can run to. And that's why sometimes you may not realize this, that pastors sometimes are the most depressed people that you will know. Yeah, they just put up a good preaching front. Sometimes they're most depressed. And that statistics say that almost 90 or 80% of all pastors do not finish their ministry race. They drop off along the side. Hallelujah. So back to the conversation. So I was in a very dark place. I'd gone through all of this church trouble and my soul. I'd just gotten exhausted. I remember I was depressed because I would sit down in my back office and I would just cry. I know it has never happened to you, but this is my story. I will cry at midnight. I will cry in the morning. I will cry in the evening. I will cry. I will say, why am I even doing this? Why am I here? And I began to have suicidal thoughts. I had suicidal thoughts so much that I sent a message to my wife one day at about 3 or 4 a.m. I said, just in case anything happens, this is what I have and this is what I don't have. This is what I want to know. This is what I don't want to know. And I wrote a message. I said, my ATM card, this is a pin. This is a pin to this. I wrote something very detailed. I said, this I do not have. This I do have. This looks like my own. It's not my own. And my wife woke up and saw the message and replied to me and said, what do you mean? I said, I'm just saying. And my wife was smart enough to call one of my closest and covenant friends. And he flew in. And when he flew in, he came to me and said, I saw the message you sent to your wife. I just need to let you know I'm here to solve it. I said, first of all, I booked an hotel close to your house. I'm going to stay here until there's nothing to discuss again, until you stop feeling this way. So it's either you recover from this place or I will stay and live in your house. You know, and thank God for friends like that. I hope you have those kind of friends. I hope you have those kind of friends. And let me tell you something. If you don't have those kind of friends, joining the small group, like one of our leaders said earlier, is a junction. Let me tell you something. Ever look at me. Isolation is one of the biggest causes of depression. That was why during COVID-19, when there was social distancing, a lot of people sank into depression. Isolation. And I always say this to you. Isolation precedes destruction. Isolation precedes destruction. Listen to me. You cannot be connected in meaningful ways to relationship and feel depressed. The reason why is the relationship will pull you up. They will eventually pull you up. And I remember how I went through that. But the thing is that I thank God I'm not there again. Because I look back and I'm like, wow, why was that depressing me? You know why I'm saying so to you today? The reason I'm saying so, this is very powerful. The reason I'm saying so is that many of you are here and you've been depressed at one point or the other. And when you get out of it, you're shocked at how that thing could have made you that way. Who knows what I'm talking about? Exactly. You're shocked like, well, why was I so bothered? Like, let me ask just a quick question. Who went through a breakup that almost destroyed you? And you look back and you're like, I was stupid. Wave your hands. Give him the microphone. Give me the microphone. Give me the microphone. Yeah. Tell me. Yes, the breakup that almost shattered you and finished your self-esteem, yes.
Not too far ago.
Not too far ago.
I was in a very interesting relationship. And I thought I couldn't, you know, I thought I wasn't going to recover. I was going to find someone better. So, oh, come on. People are feeling sad for me. So I was in a situation where...
Hold on. I know some of your story. So is it the one that is international? This... Because the relationship he's... I'm not right. He was talking about his mom went to beg the lady and said, please, don't break up with him.
True.
Just imagine what would make your mother go and beg somebody else and say, please marry, date. You beg to be married, you were refused how many times?
Plenty times.
you beg. No, they were dating. How many is it they dated?
We're dating about two and a half years.
They dated and let's move. I'm not moving. Looking back, what would you advise your younger self if you could see the future? If you could talk to your younger self, what would you have told your younger self?
The person that is coming is 100 times better than the person you're leaving.
Awesome. What's going on? What am I not saying? What is it? What? Oh, right. So, which is very powerful. You know why I share this kind of stories with you? Because we keep hearing the stories of Peter, James, John. But I want to hear the story of Pastor Stacy. I want to hear the story of Pastor George. I want to hear the story of Bodger right there. I want to hear the story. I want to hear the stories. Because it's good to say that, you know, in the Bible days, this was in the Bible days. Because let me tell you something about depression. When you're depressed, it's difficult to believe it can get better. And if that's where you are, I understand. Because I was in that place. I was so depressed, I thought the end of the world had come. Because depression has a way of magnifying what is wrong and leaving what is right. But when you step out of depression, you look back and be like, that thing was not as bad as I thought. And it was just in between my ears that I magnified it. Glory to God. I said, glory to God. So that's my own story of depression. And I went through this huge depression. And I'm saying it today because in this series, I want to be able to help brothers and sisters like me. The first thing is that born again people have the tendency to deny that they suffer depression. Because in our mind, depression means that you're not strong spiritually. That's what the born-again mind said. But guess what? Which of the prophets of the Bible that was anointed did not go to a top patch? In fact, today we're talking about a prophet called Elijah. Elijah is one of the most extensive cases of depression. We're going to see it in a minute. And the reason I'm saying so is this. If you were going to depression, you need to admit it, because whatever you don't admit, you cannot change. You need to admit that this is killing me. You know what depression does? Depression changes people. You become irritable. This is not what you used to be. How many of you have seen someone that was your friend before and you saw them 5 years after and they're totally different? Totally different negatively. Have you seen someone like that before? Wave your hands and let me see. So you're like, and you're like, what happened to you? Because they've shrunk, they're emaciated, they've lost their self-esteem, and it's obvious that they've moved into a place of depression. And while we're talking about friends, some of you are here today, hey, you're really struggling. The thing with depression is this, the same way your body can be sick, depression is a sickness of the soul. And that's why when people are depressed and you say man up, remember malaria, do you say man up? No, you say go get help. When people are depressed and you say man up, it's not something they man up, because it's not a character flaw. It's something that needs healing. It's something that needs a procedure to help them. Oh, glory to God. I said, glory to God. I said, glory to God. I said, glory to God. And the thing about depression is this. Let me tell you why it makes it worse. All the time I was depressed, nobody knew. Because depression can be covered with clothes, nice look, and good English. With your bone, tell me the name. Bone straight. Yeah, with your bone straight, you have what? A dry heart. Bone straight, then what? Bone dead heart. Oh, you know, so you're like, but your heart is dead. You can, you know, I understand you wear all this design. And some of you wear, you know why you wear expensive things? You wear expensive things to cover your debt. You wear expensive to cover your ugliness. Because your heart and your soul is dead. What does depression look like? Let's turn the Bible, Job chapter 19, verse 2. Job chapter 19, verse 2. And let me say this to you quickly. What happened is not as important as how you respond to it. What happened is not what? As important as how you respond to it. Job chapter 19, verse 2. In this month's teaching, you will learn what is causing you to be depressed. You will learn how to avoid it. Because the thing is that this one is not about depression, and this is why this should be different from all the things we've done in the fourth service, is that when people are depressed, they can get better. But after some months, they find themselves going back to it. You must know something. There is a pattern of depression. Job chapter, where's the scripture? I thought they're going to put on the screen. Job chapter 19, verse 2. Okay, let's go. See what depression looks like. The writer of Job says, how long will you vex my soul? When people are depressed, you see that internal frustration. Sometimes it's a man that is depressed and it takes out on the whole family because his job is not going well. Or maybe he lost some money. Sometimes it's a lady that is depressed and it takes out on all the other men that are yet to come. Sometimes that's what it is. There's that deep frustration. You're just angry. You are agitated. You are pained. You know. Is it, how are you? Do I look like I'm not fine? Glory to God. I said glory to God. What does depression look like? Psalm 42 verse 6. Psalm 42 verse 6. What does depression look like? So what is not depression? You know, this is a generation where everybody says, I am depressed. It's like a slogan, like, oh, you're not depressed? Get depressed. Like, if you're not depressed, what's wrong with you? It's mental health. So I just think that is a lot of emphasis on the wrong thing. Depression is not the feeling of being, depression is not feeling down. That's not depression. Depression is not feeling low. That's not depression. Depression is not feeling upset. That's not depression. Depression is not feeling unhappy. That's not depression. Those can happen to you when you're depressed, but those are natural human day emotions. So if you feel low, you're not depressed. Depression is not a character flaw. It's not a sign of personal weakness or indiscipline. Depression is not even the sadness you experience after the loss of someone or loss of money. Those are just natural human reactions to events. What is depression? Depression is a state. It's not a one day, one, two thing. It's a place you find yourself predominantly. If you experience that sadness, you are sad almost 20 hours out of 24. If you find that's where you are depressed. See what the Bible says here. The psalmist said, oh God, he said, my soul is cast down. One of the things you notice about depressive is that there's a helplessness. That's when you want to depress. Let's fast and pray. He said, if you want to pray, pray. Me, I'm not praying. If God wants to help, let him help me. If he's not helping, let him not help. I'm okay. And the reason, and that's why when you want to help depressed people, oh Lord, look at me. When you want to help depressed people, you can't say, come to church. You have to drag them. You have to carry them. You have to go and say, take your bat in front of me. Let's go together. Because if you say, come, Trust me, they will not come. The reason why is that they are so helpless about their state, they are unwilling to help themselves. In fact, depressed people begin to sabotage themselves. They begin to do things that will hurt themselves. Helplessness. So one of the signs of depression is helplessness. I want us to read 1 Kings chapter 19. And we'll look into the life of this anointed prophet of God called Elijah. And we'll look at, you know, what, how he suffered depression. And maybe this will help you. Maybe in this service, maybe I can go deeper. Amen. Do you have something to write? Oh, wow. You know what I will do? I will just keep it for next week. I want to give you a test that you can just take. It's just a test. And just know how you are doing. All right. So let's go. 1 Kings chapter 19, verse 1. And Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done. And with how he had slain all the prophets with the sword. And Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah, say, so the gods do to me and more if I don't make your life as one of them by tomorrow. Let me ask a question. Can you give me the message translation? Is it possible or not? Let me know. At the back, just tell me. The message translation is very sweet. Thank you. Oh, wow. Thank you. Let me switch to message translation. Yeah. So Jezebel immediately sent a messenger to Elijah with a threat. The gods will get you for this, and I will get even with you. By this time tomorrow, you'll be as dead as one of the prophets. The Bible says in verse 3, and when Elijah saw how things went, he ran for his dear life. And the second thing is this. You know, I told you, I said depression makes you helpless. You start running. I want to ask you, what are you running from? Can we break it down? Some of you, I'm running from love. Can we break it down? Some of you are running, you don't want to try again. Some of you are running from people. Some of you, you don't pick up your phones again. Because one of the things depression does is to isolate you. You just cut off of people that love you. Have you noticed that? No, talk to me. And you can see your phone ringing, but you don't want to pick up. And say, I don't want to talk. And because you are in a dark place. The Bible says, Elijah began to run. The thing is that depression will limit your potential. The reason why I say this is that, could you believe that Elijah that will call down fire and consume 150 prophets of Baal did it 3 times? The same Elijah, did it on the mount. The same Elijah, a woman threatened him. The woman didn't even see him or. The woman only sent him a DM. Look at it in the Bible. The Bible said the woman sent him a messenger. It was Facebook message. And the man took off. The man did not even see how the man organized, arranged. Because in the Bible, there is no evidence that the woman ever did anything physical. She only threatened. The question is that, what threat are you responding to? And Elijah began to run. What are you running from? What are you running from? Can we look up here? Could it be the very thing you want is what you're running from? You want to do well in business, but because of all the failures you've had, you're running away from taking business risk. Because of all the disappointments you had with applications, you're running away from applying. Because of all the people that disappointed you with help, you are running away from asking for help. What the biggest thing you want is a person that will love you, an intimate relationship, and take you for who you are. But guess what you're running from? Every time a woman or a man shows up in your life, that's what you're running from. The biggest thing you want is someone that you can be free with. But guess what you run from? You run away from vulnerability. You come to this church, and as soon as you see me, you take the other way. Why are you coming here? You're coming here hoping I can help you. Why are you taking the other way? Because the very thing you want is what you're running from. The very thing you want is a man in your life. Once a guy say hello, you're like, what? But that's the very thing you want. The Bible says this, and Elijah ran for his life. And you know what he did? The person that stays with him, he left his younger servant there. You see, he went into isolation. He began to leave people and began to go alone into the desert. Your isolation is causing destruction. You don't talk. You keep everything inside. And just for you to know, depression is the second cause of death in the world right now. In 2020, WHO says depression will be the number one cause of death. That the most people that are depressed are more exposed to, are more, have higher risk of having heart problems than those that smoke. And the thing is that, you know, so because you can impress with all these good looks and good glasses you have, so you think, I don't think you could be depressed. So because you can speak British English with Queen's accent and go, oh, you know, what does that mean? You're just a depressed, funny speaking person. Praise God. Oh, so because you come in your G-Wagon and in your Lexus, you can be depressed. Just depression that is driving. Praise God. And the reason why is that sometimes we hide behind these things. We hide so that when depression really gets bad, people forget. They just don't take care of themselves. But sometimes when people are very smart, they take a good mask and they hide behind the mask. You walk, you will not put extra into your walk because you don't want to face something you're running from. So the signs of depression, you could see the low self-esteem. Elijah forgot who he was. You could see the helplessness. You could see the fear, the anxiety. The lady didn't do anything, but Elijah was running. And you know what? Fear is the enemy's tool to push you into forbidden territories. Oh, inshallah. I need to sit down so that you can get it. Oh, get it first. Once you get it, let me know. Have you gotten it? Fear is the enemy's tool to push you into forbidden territories. There are territories you will not get into except you're afraid. So the devil uses fear to pull you inside. Because when you're afraid, you will act irrationally. Fear will make you date the wrong person. Fear will make the wrong decision. Fear is the enemy's tool to drag you into what? Unknown territories. So you can't find yourself loving again because of fear. Glory to God. What do you see with Elisha? Oh my God, this is very powerful. The Bible says, and he came into a lone broom bush and collapsed on its side, wanting in the worst day to be done with it all. Oh wow. Bible says, and he came to a lone broom bush. A lone broom bush. And collapse in its shade, wanting in the worst way to be done with it all. See, listen to what it says. It says, wanting in the worst way. He was now sabotaging. He was wanting the worst for himself. How can a prophet be wanting the worst for himself? Wanting the worst way to be done with it all. To what? What would he want? To just die. What did he want? Enough of this, oh God. Take my life. I'm ready to join my ancestors in the grave. He became suicidal. And the reason I'm reading this to you is this is the first thing I want to do. If this is where you are, I've been there. If this is where you are, the prophet Elijah has been there. I don't know what happened to you. I mean, today I've had huge stories. One man in the first service, he had a divorce, and I think it's a popular family. And he said, because of the divorce, that the divorce became a social media news for 6 months. She said, I couldn't go anywhere for 1 year because I was afraid that everybody was talking about me. I couldn't walk. I couldn't step out. I was just afraid that the whole country was talking about me. But how long will you keep living in the shadows? And some of you, you've experienced this, but you couldn't put a word to you that was going wrong with you. You know the thing about depression? Some of you, the reason why you have depression is not even something that happened to you. It was an emotional state you inherited from your single mom or your single father or from your parents. But it must stop somewhere. When you see people that, when you see, especially single parents that raised depressed kids, you can easily see the depression on the kids if they are not careful. If they are not careful. Because you see the kids, it's either they'll be a bit withdrawn. I've never seen those kids before. They will just have that nerdy kind of behavior. Like, I don't know, the words coming to my mouth, I'm not sure I can say it. Praise God. So the first thing is that we want to help us identify, is this where we are? That's what I want to do today. Hey, this is where we are. And if this is where we are, how do we go forward from here? How do we go forward from what? From here. Let's keep reading about Elijah. The Bible says, exhausted, he fell asleep upon the broom, in the low broom bushel. Suddenly an angel shook him awake and said, get up and eat. And he looked, see, I don't know if you noticed the sign of depression there. That people with depression, they stop taking care of themselves. They stop eating. So the angel said, get up and eat. And when they eat things that will destroy them. Glory to God. Is this blessing you today? Okay, let me take a comment. I want someone to share with me what your own story, what your journey of depression is. Can I get another microphone on this side to make it fast? I want someone to share with me what your own story and depression is. Okay, how do we go? Let's go through the lady first. And I want someone at the back. No, the lady here, right in front of me. Yeah.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Good afternoon, church.
Good afternoon.
Okay, mine started from school, and when my daddy disowned me, like he mentioned, I had my baby when I was in 311.
You had the baby when you were in 311. Yes.
So during
that
period,
led him to disown you.
Yeah, because during that period, those times, I was in school. I could not go home because they asked me not to come home. My mom was the one communicating with me. So the fact that I'm just in school, everybody goes home after break, you know, when we are on this semester's break and all, but I'm at home alone. And sometimes I'll just pass through. It is.
So when you were depressed, how did you feel?
Rejected. Like, I was tired. I just want to die.
You were feeling suicidal?
Yes, rejection. Yes, suicidal, rejection. Because I cannot go home. I cannot meet my siblings. He said I must not call my mom. He was giving them the information to give me that I should not just try it. So I was always alone in the school. The old hostel, everybody goes home, but I'm the only one there.
How did that change your life? How did that change how you felt about life?
Oh, I felt like the old world is falling on me at that period.
So that's another thing that depression does. You become negative. You become negative and you see the word negative. Thank you. Okay, let's move. Where's Lydia was trying to share? Where's she? Okay, move. Just let's go to the back again. Let's go to the back. Let's go. Move. I want people at the back because I don't get to see them, you know, clearly. Yeah. Anybody at the back raise up their hands to share? Yeah. I can't see that, but I would love to.
Good afternoon, church.
Good afternoon.
So my own depression started, and I never even knew it was depression. So I almost mentally gave up. I mean, mentally ran mad. I didn't know, to be honest. I was just so hyperactive until someone saw me. And the person was like, hey, hello. I hardly notice people though. And I'm like, do you know me? He said, yes. I saw you and you're still wearing the same clothes you wore. That was 3 days ago. That was when it got dawned on me that something was wrong. Now, this...
Hold on. For 3 days, you hadn't slept or taken your bath? Or you had lost memory?
Not at all.
What? No, what is not at all?
I hadn't slept. I didn't even notice. I was just walking everywhere. I just don't know until that person said it. I don't know people, but I greet almost everybody. So when the person said hello, I'm like, do you know me? Said, yes, I saw you 3 days ago and you're still wearing the same clothes you're wearing.
For 3 days, you hadn't slept.
Yes. Yes. And my boss at that time, because I was not around, my condition made me leave Lagos. So I went to the East and I was all by myself.
What led to your depression?
Okay, so it happened when I had my son. Everyone, like normal, disowned me. My baby daddy sending me all sorts of messages and everything. I was a very bright person, but with my circumstance, I felt lonely and locked up. So I had to like...
Okay, can we pause for a minute? Can I say something? Most times people that criticize people that have children in that marriage are church people. Listen. We would rather have them do an abortion and look like a saint than let them have a baby and we support them. Or rather, let them use one sin to cover another sin than them have a baby and we protect them. The lady, I salute you. If God were to expose, I would have done an abortion here. When I say expose, not girls. And the guys. Because abortion is two ways. Nobody gets pregnant by themselves. So, what is wrong in we just be supportive? Because they did something wrong. You can condemn the sin, but don't condemn the sinner. Back to your story.
Okay, so this is something that usually happen. Okay, so for like 10 years, obviously, my son is 11 last month, but for like 10 years, I don't eat. And people will be like, you're killing yourself, you don't like yourself, blah, blah, blah. I don't even know I was thinking, I don't even know what was wrong with me at all. And I'll always be grateful to Average Stars and my friend who introduced me to the church. Because now I can eat without thinking. I spend so much on food, expensive food.
Did you notice that for 10 years she just told that she was in a state? That it affected even her eating. You know, I'm grateful. You know, I'm grateful that even though this is not what a lot of churches will do, and some people may even criticize us for it, but I'm grateful that we get to really help people. I'm really grateful that I'm grateful. It takes a lot of courage because sometimes people are like, why are you not doing this? Why are you not doing that? Why are you trying to be different? I'm like, well, maybe because we want to really help people and they want to beat us and intimidate and criticize us into conformity. But that's just a beautiful story to hear. And so when she was depressed, she was isolated. She couldn't sleep. She couldn't eat because just so much evil. Thank you. Thank you for sharing that story with us. Thank you for sharing that story with us. So the question is this, and then I want us to tidy up from here. We've seen the different symptoms of depression. And one of the things, and let me tell you something, if you have a friend that is depressed, you need to drag them to come, not invite them, drag them to come. And the question is that, how do I get out of it? And that's what I'm teaching this month. Next we're going to look at the causes of depression. Then exactly how do you step out of it? And when you have, how do you step out of it? How do you maintain your joy and your peace? You know what? In this world, I cannot assure you that negative will not happen. But what I can assure you is that you can be positive amongst negativity. How do I learn that? Jesus is asleep in the boat in the midst of the storm. That's peace. Peace is not absence of the storm. Peace is that in the storm, I can keep my joy. That's peace. Peace is not that nothing will go wrong. It's that when everything goes wrong, my peace will stay intact. My joy will stay intact. That's peace. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Let's turn to the last scripture, John chapter 14. John chapter 14. And one of the things you notice when you start getting depressed is you start blaming. You either blame yourself, you blame your parents, or you blame God. Who did you blame? Give that lady the phone, the microphone. Who did you blame when you were going through that depression? Who did you blame?
I blamed myself because
Who else did you blame?
I blame myself. I grew up, my dad trained me in a way that you make your own decision.
Fantastic. So you blamed yourself. Did you blame your boyfriend for?
No, I still blame myself.
You still blamed yourself. Great. Did you blame God for making it happen?
No, I blame myself.
That's great. A lot of people get pregnant and say, God, why did you do this to me? You're laughing. Have you never heard it before? Like, God, why? God, someone said, God, it was just the first time I tried it. I'm like, oh, wow. Praise God. Amen. So I'm only saying to you, the two stories we heard today, they got depressed because they had a child out of wedlock. And that sunk them down. But some people, it will be a divorce. Some people, it will be loss of money. It will be loss of money. Some people, it will be the fact that other people are ahead of me and I'm behind. There would always be one thing that would trigger depression. But what happened is not as important as how you respond to what happened. Praise God. It's so powerful. Okay, let me ask a... Job chapter 14, verse 7. Let me ask a final one. Anybody here that you're really, really depressed right now? Raise up your hands. There's a lady over there. Let's get the microphone. That's why I love the fourth service. We can get to help, right? Yeah. John chapter 14, verse 7. Why are they getting the microphone? Let's look on the screen. John chapter 14, verse 7. John 14, verse 7. Job, not John. Job 14, verse 7. I made a mistake. Job 14, verse 7. I love the book of John. Job 14, verse 7. Praise the Lord. Job 14, verse 7. See what the Bible says. Can we read together? Let's read together, right? One to go. For there's hope of a tree, if it be cut down, that it will sprout again, that the tender branches therefore will not cease. Verse 8. Though the root thereof wax in the earth, and the stalk thereof die in the ground. Verse 9. It's a board. You didn't hear that? He said, no matter how you're cut down, he said, if you can stay rooted and there's water, you will bud again. Where's my guy? Where is he? You need to switch the microphone with someone. Yeah. This is what I'm saying to you. Stand here. No matter what happens, keep your foot in the ground. Stay grounded. You had a divorce come, stay grounded. You lost money, stay grounded. You know, you lost a child, stay grounded. You didn't get the approval, stay grounded. You didn't get the job, stay grounded. Whatever it is, stay grounded. Why? As long as your roots are in the ground, you will bud again. The problem is this. This is the problem. The problem is this. That when things happen, they knock you out completely because you don't have roots. How do you put the root in the ground? Put your root in the Word of God and say, even though I'm dying, I will join an LP. I will read the scriptures. You know, look at the scripture we read this last week about daddy. That it says, you pamper me. Because there's something about the scripture that gives you root. Look at the next slide. It says, once you can stay grounded, it says, through what? Through the saint of water. It says, through the saint of water will happen. It will bring forth again. To the saint of water to bring forth again. Lady, you're so dry. You need water. And you need somebody to get water. You're trying to make it up. You're trying to make it up. You're trying to cover your thirst. You're trying to cover all of those things. You're so dry. You need water to come into that place. And let the water of God's word make it moist. Okay. Praise God. And that's why you see what happens every Sunday here. Because people are getting blessed. Because the water of God's word is able to help people. Yes, my lady, as we close.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. Yeah.
I'm still depressed.
Yeah.
And even on Friday night.
So why are you depressed?
A lot of things are just happening.
Okay. So tell me this. Tell me why you think you're depressed.
Because for the past 2 years, that is since 2022, I've just been trying to like avoid everybody, no friends, be on my own. Because I will tell people that I don't need friends because I don't want problem. And I know deep down I need friends. I will not ask for help because I feel I can do it. And I know deep down I need help. So even on Friday night inside the bus, I already said to myself that it's just better I go home. I know I can't die in Lagos because there's nobody to reach out to my parents. So I said to myself that on Friday, I'll just save up transport and go home because I can't continue like this. It's better I die in my parents' house. So I don't know. But so, I've been listening to your teachings, even on Sunday last week. And I said to myself, I know deep down I need help. Why don't I ask for help?
So the question is this. What is causing the depression? So you told me that you are isolating. So but what is causing it? What are the problems you have that is causing it?
Okay.
Can you stand up so that I can see you better, please? Yeah, tell me.
It started in 2020. I had a failed relationship, and that was when I came to Lagos. I was in a fashion academy, and I was doing very well. And the person that was supporting me just withdrew back. And after that, I didn't try to do anything again.
You didn't see how she became helpless? Yeah. Yeah, continue.
So I've just been roaming about. I know it. I've not tried to do anything because even when I want to do it.
So you were in the East, right?
No, I've been.
You were in Lagos, in the academy here?
Yes, yes.
Okay, great. So why didn't you continue? There was no money because of the support.
Yes, even when the money came, I was feeling so scared that I can't do it. Even right now, I'm into makeup, and still yet, I will still have that thought that since it's me, I can't do it. And most times, even when I want to pray, I will just say to myself, no need to pray because it's me, so God won't answer my prayers. So I've been saying it. I do tell my friends, most of them that listen to me, I know deep down I need help, and that's why I came here today.
Okay. So the root of this is that your relationship failed. So why does a relationship fail make you feel as if your life is over?
I don't know.
No, you know because there's something you tell yourself. So why does relationship fail make you feel as if your life is over? Why does it affect you so much?
Maybe I was expecting more than what I got.
You were expecting more than what you got?
Yes.
Okay. So what's wrong with that?
I just want to be okay. I've not slept and woken up the same. If I wake up, I know that pain is still there. I've been pretending.
So let me ask you a question. If you'd be okay, what would that look like? The boy will come back to your life?
No.
So what would that look like?
At least I'll be able to do other things.
You need to do other things. So what do you need to be to do other things?
I need to be fine.
You need to be fine. What does fine mean? You don't know. Okay. So every day, so you said that everything's not working since that breakup, right? Okay, so tell me 5 things that are not working.
The thing is that I don't believe in myself.
You don't believe in yourself?
Yes.
So why don't you believe in yourself?
I don't know.
No, you have to know. You're not answering my questions. You have to know. If you don't answer my questions, there's no way I can help you.
Because I don't believe in myself, because if I want to try it, I'll just say it's me. It's not going to work out.
Good, good. So I can tell what the problem is. Yeah, I wanted the camera to stay on her because I want to say, so look at me, look at me. You hold the microphone to your mouth. Put your right hand on your chest. Tap it, tap it, tap it, tap it, tap it like this. Look at me. Don't close your eyes. Say, I'm a success.
I'm a success.
Say, I'm a success.
I'm a success.
Say, I'm a success.
I'm a success.
Why are you squinting?
I'm scared.
Why are you scared?
Because I know even if I go home, I will still be scared. Like, can I do this? Can I move out of this state?
Yeah. Who knows what is wrong? The fundamental thing that is wrong is what she's saying. It's not just what she's saying with her mouth, it's what she's saying to herself. Did you see? You know why I said she'll have your success? You know why she was squinting? Her system does not agree with what she's saying. So as she was saying it, her system was repelling it, that what you are saying is not familiar to us. Say, you know, it's like you hear someone speaking French and you don't understand French, your system will be confused. Two things. That's your second problem. Your first problem is this. I'll tell you. I mean, it's a public space. I wanted to ask your age, but maybe I should not do that. Do you have parents?
Yes.
Do you have parents?
Yes.
If you die, what will happen to them?
To affect them.
What do you love the most in this world?
My dad.
Your dad. What's your dad's name?
Fidelis.
What?
Fidelis.
Mr. Fidelis.
Yes.
How does it feel if he hears this from you?
He will feel sad because I can't even open up to them because I know it will still hurt them.
It will still hurt them?
Yes.
But if you die, what will happen to Mr. Fidelis?
To hurt them. To hurt him.
The reason, let me tell you what you need to do. I will tell you and we'll get there. The first thing to get out of this is that you need to find a reason to come out of it. Ever look at me. I want to give you a big secret. Until you find something greater than your pain, you will leave it. You've not found a reason for purpose or existence. That's the reason why. When you find, some of you here, you were down. It was a child. It was something that made you get up. Your change is going to come when you find something bigger than your pain. Everyone here that has refused to change, the only reason why you have not changed is that you have not found something bigger than your pain. I'll give you a story. There was a woman that was very depressed and was going to die. And she had written out she was going to kill herself and all of that. Then one day, her children stumbled upon it. And her children had said, Mommy, don't worry about killing yourself. That part of your side knows that we're disturbing you. You know that she doesn't want to be a burden. He said, we will kill herself first. When they said that to the woman, that day the woman changed. You know why? Because all of a sudden, there was a bigger pain than what she was going through. She had to change from depression to joy instantly. She now had to be the one to cheer up the children just because of what it is. What is your name, please?
Margaret.
Margaret, the challenge is that you don't have what to live for. And you need to give me that thing or else I cannot help you. What do you want? Do you want to make your father proud, Mr. Fidelis?
Yes.
You want to make him proud?
Yes.
How will you make him proud? Tell me what will make him proud.
If he sees me become a successful person.
How? In what?
My line of business.
Which line of business?
My makeup.
In your makeup?
Yes.
So just imagine that you own a store somewhere in VI and you invite Mr. Fidelis to come. What will he be wearing? What will Mr. Fidelis be wearing when he's coming? What will he wear? Will he wear shirt and tie? Will he wear native attire? What's he going to wear when he's coming from the east?
Native.
He'll wear the, what color?
White.
White. What will your store be? Will it be in VI or will it be in Lagos Island or it will be in Lekki? What will your store be?
To be in Lekki.
It will be in Lekki. Where in Lekki will this store be?
Like
face one. What street? You know the street? You know the street? No. You know the street? No. But will he be along Admiralty? Will he be along Admiralty?
Yes.
Yes. So when your father comes, will he come with walking stick? Or will he come with walking stick or just come like that?
He's going to come in a car.
He's going to come with a car.
Yes.
So, So when he comes to the car, when he comes to the car, and you see, what's he going to say when he says to you, tell me?
Onyaga, you've made me proud.
Is he going to say it in English or say in native language?
He's going to say it in English.
In English.
Call me by my native name.
Call him, say it the way we say it, call your native name.
Onyaga, you've made me proud.
What will he say when he says that?
Because right from time, he knows I'm a strong person.
No. That's what I'm asking. What will you say? So when your dad says, Onyaga, you have made me proud, what will you say?
Say, God did it.
You say, God did it.
Yes.
How do you feel right now? Do you still feel afraid?
I feel I can do it if I want to.
You know the only thing that changed? Hebrews says that, who for the joy ahead of him endured the pain. What I was able to do for you was in the principle in Hebrew. I was able to paint a picture of the future so that you can break through the pain you're going through. You know what you're going to do for me? Let's go over it again. Close your eyes. I wanted to see you sending money to your dad. And your dad saying thank you and calling you to say thank you. I want to see you calling your dad and telling them how the store is doing right now in VI. I want to see yourself in the store. See yourself in that store. Is it one room or two rooms? How big is the store? Is it on the ground floor or on the top floor? I wanted to call your dad and say, Daddy, I'm going to send you a ticket to come into my store. Have you called him? Have you called him? Did he pick up the phone?
Yes.
Where was he when he picked up the phone? Do you see where he is?
He's sitting in the living room.
In the sitting room. And he picked up the phone.
Yes.
And when you told him that you're going to send him a ticket to come to your store, what did he say?
He doesn't even believe he can even enter a plane.
He doesn't even believe it. So, is he crying? Is he laughing? Or is he telling your mom? Is he telling, who is he telling?
He's crying.
He's crying?
Yes.
Then he enters the plane. Then when he comes up on the plane, he sees your driver picking him at the airport. And when your driver picks him at the airport, he asks that, whose car is this? What does the driver say?
It's for your daughter.
It's for your daughter. What did your dad say when your driver said that?
He doesn't believe it because he doesn't own a car.
He doesn't own a car?
Yes.
Look at me. How do you feel right now?
I feel like I can do it.
You feel like
because
I can do
I
it?
Because I know I can do it.
Come, let me give you a hug. Come. Help ever make a way forward. You must learn to fill your mind with positive thoughts. Come. Help her. Tell me. What are you saying?
I can do it. And I have to do it. No matter how the challenges, I have to do it. Because I have sisters that they look up to me too.
Yeah.
I have to do it. I can do it.
Yeah. You can.
I can do it.
You can. You can.
I can do it.
You can do it.
Yes. You're not going back the same.
You're not going back the same. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
I will do it.
You'll do it, right?
Yes.
You will do it, right? Yes, you will take care of your sisters, right?
Yes.
You will take care of your dad, right?
Yes.
You will make your dad proud, right?
Yes.
You will make Jesus proud, right?
Yes.
Yes, you can. You can.
I can.
You can. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Oh, wow. Oh, wow. Let's give the Lord a big shout. Oh, mine. Oh. Wow. Sometimes what everybody needs is that person to lean on. What everybody needs is that person to wipe my handkerchief. What everybody needs is that person that can say that I will be here. I will be here. I will stand with you. And the reason why is that sometimes we're so concerned with ourselves and we don't realize that when we ask someone's miracle. And you need to make up your mind today to become a blessing to somebody else with your words, with your presence. You need to become a gift. Thank you. You know, you need to become a gift to somebody else. Stand on your feet. Let's pray. Put your hands on your neighbor and pray for that person next to you. Don't pray for yourself today. Pray for someone next to you. Just take one name and pray for that person. Pray for that person. And Father, we thank you for your love and kindness. And thank you for bringing hope and bringing people out of darkness. We give you praise. We honor you, Lord Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Let me tell all of you, choose to be that strength for somebody else. It's a choice you have to make. Be that strength for somebody else. Choose to be that strength for somebody else. You see, I go from I can't to I can. Then, you know what she did that was very powerful, and this is what I believe. She began to look for reasons why she must. She said, I need to take care of my four sisters. I need to take care of my four. And when you give yourself, see, when you give yourself a powerful reason, you'll find a way. Amen. This month's series on overcoming depression will be really good. Some of you have friends that are going, just bring them and let's trust God to touch them. You know, tell them about our God that can heal and touch people. God bless you. Can have your seats. Hallelujah.